all settled in, and you turn to me to close the door there. Okay, so as you see, the topic is prioritization. And we're talking about prioritization in many ways. I'm going to define prioritization. The simple definition is deciding what you're going to do in the short term. In agile terms, that would be deciding what you're going to do on the next sprint, put it in direct agile terms. So that's prioritization. And then the question is, I have some what's called digital ways of deciding, rather than intuitive or populist ways or something like that. I use numbers to decide, is that long and short of it. These slides are available. They're available on a Dropbox site, which I should be kind enough to. Yeah, is that there now? Has anybody found my slides yet? I'm not sure it's there now, okay. But it could be. Let's see. Tiny URL 1755. I'll just write that up there in case somebody wants to take up. They might be quite useful because some of them, as you saw, can be tables with small numbers. So you might like to have it on your. Not a lot of people have their laptop there, but anyway. TinyURL, .com at, it's here, let's see, Guild 17 July. Yes, that works. Nice. But then you could follow this on your whatever, iPhone, laptop, or at least you know you've got it here, no matter what. Okay, did anybody manage to look that up?
Yes.
The files are there?
Yes.
Okay, we have confirmation. That works. So, you know, if you don't do it there, go back to whatever. Okay. So I've also subtitled this, actually two subtitles. One, I'm going to talk about my planning language, known as Planguage, and my project management method known as EVO, Evolutionary Value Delivery, okay? Which some say is the first agile, decades before the Agile Manifesto, okay? But it's, the Agile Manifesto and current versions of Agile have one sickness, and is they don't seem to care very much about values or costs. They care about code, and I've never been there. Okay, but they do care about coding in sprints. Okay, now, I think architecture is arguably about values and costs, not about coding. Architecture can be done without any coding. Okay, so we're not published. Anyway, these are the frameworks. The frameworks are in the books, which I already gave you a shot at getting the links to get them for free. Okay, and you'll get another one in this set of slides. Okay, so you're going to get book length treatment for free. Okay, on these subjects. So I hope what this hour does is get you interested enough to get the books, read the first page or two, and see if you want to continue, something like that. Go ahead. Or come on the BCS courses. We already have dates in the fall for BCS courses, which are free here. So do come along and get to train for a day or two or three. Another subtitle is a deep dive into advanced architecture theory and practice. So it's deep. It's too deep for one day. I mean, I wouldn't mind a week or two with you. With some of this. The books, by the way, are 500 pages and 800 pages respectively, and they're dense with ideas, like 10 ideas per page. Right? So there's nothing simple about it. You're going to need to master this, you're going to need to do your 10,000 hours of civics. Okay? But today, maybe the first hour or something like that, or we will see. But anyway, now advanced architecture theory, I believe this is advanced because most architectural frameworks do not go into this quantification of values and costs and relations at all. They don't even start there. Okay, they're totally absent. Yeah. I remember I had a long talk with John Zachman, many of you will know, we had a lovely dinner with Lauren, actually. I presented my methods to him, and I basically fishing for compliments. I said, do you think my methods are better than your methods for architecture? And he said, well, of course they are. So aren't you going to change anything? He said, no, I'm too old, had too many lawsuits, I'm not going to go there. So this is the fact that it's better, most intelligent architectural methods people would admit. But they're already selling what they're selling, how they're selling it, and they're not prepared to change anything. So you're going to get it from me, or you're not going to get it. You're not going to get it from them changing their methods. Okay? They're just too long to what they're doing. Maybe I'm too long to what I'm doing, and somebody will say that about me. But right now, I'm the advanced guy. I'm one level up. I'm going to the engineering level so we can quantify and communicate better about architecture. Okay. Theory and practice. So I'm going to show you some practical stuff, and I'm going to show you some theory, and I hope you, the summary, your own summary is, I really ought to look into this. So I'd be unhappy if you said, it's too difficult for me. It may seem difficult, like a lot of new things do, but it really isn't very difficult. But it does take a little bit of practice and learning, like everything. Okay, so we'll start off with some examples, and I'm going to use examples from courses we've held at, we use these things for real projects, but they tend to be confidential. But the courses we hold at BCS are not confidential, so I'm choosing examples from them. And then after we've done the examples for about a half an hour or so, we'll turn to theory, which will in fact contain some quite a few examples and case studies. Now, first slide, I don't know if I should apologize because the print's small or not, but I'm trying to put everything in there. But you don't really have to read the text. On this axis, we have a set of stakeholders, okay? And all you really have to do is register the fact that I think we've been very poor in IT about teaching stakeholder analysis. There are a few of us who are campaigning for it. We're getting some ground. We're at the 5 or 10% level of people knowing what it is and doing it. But everybody else is with the use cases and user stories. The user is the whole stakeholder level thing. Okay? And stakeholders are a much broader concept. And mature disciplines and complex disciplines, such as systems engineering, have a well-developed stakeholder culture. That's the fact. Okay, but we're not there yet, this IT gang at BCS. Okay? Or let's find out, how many people say, Tom, when I work, or where I work, we have a well-developed stakeholder analysis process. Yeah, fine, okay, but the vast majority not raising their hands. Note for the camera, which is on here, by the way.
Is that how you talk about a common framework that people understand?
I'm really just asking, do you have a phase where you're saying, now we're going to do stakeholder analysis? And you make a big long list of the energy operations director and the prime minister and the other problems, and these are your stakeholders. Then you say about stakeholders, what are your needs? What are you looking for? Some of these needs will be converted into requirements if we can do them profitably and have enough budget and technology. That's the architectural job. Is to convert the stakeholders' needs into technology that can be implemented. That's architecture. I can't understand that architecture can work well if it doesn't have the stakeholder perspective as its start. Okay. I've written masses on this. I found that I couldn't find a good book on it at all. I found very few papers or presentations, but through the last 5 or 10 years, I've collected a lot on stakeholders. It's getting better and better, but it's not a for IT people, it's just sort of an emerging idea. Anyway, symbolically, this is a list of stakeholders for a problem. Now, here it says stakeholder value, and there are some values like national health, national security, preventing harm, supply availability, public space safety. Okay, and these are the values. Now, notice these are nice-sounding values, But I promise you, they are all quantified by the time we do the first day of the course. We have a culture that says nice sounding words are never enough. They will always get misinterpreted by everybody in the chain. The only way to prevent misinterpretation is to define them very carefully, which includes, but is not limited to, numeric definition. We'll see that in more detail. Okay, but it's just like all values, always quantified, no exceptions, no soft requirements. Okay, by quantified, I don't mean turned into money. I mean directly handling the security value itself. Okay, so that's that. But anyway, that's this. Now, down here, we have the architecture. Okay, at least symbolic. Remember, this is a student project over 2 days, so there are things that are not perfect here because the students aren't yet perfect after 2 days, but don't worry about it. The point is, we have a set of technical ideas which are intended to help us reach our stakeholder values. Here are the stakeholders holding those values, and there's some other stuff floating around, such as development resources. Okay, so if you like, this is a map of the architectural territory. The architect has to know their stakeholders, know their values and know them quantitatively, has to be aware of limitations to budgets and time and legal restrictions, and then has to come up with compatible architecture that does not violate any of the constraints. In other words, you can afford it, it's not illegal. And it does deliver the degrees of security or prevention of terrorist attack or whatever you're interested in. Okay, that's the architectural problem. Okay, so this is an overall map of an architectural set of ideas for architectural problem. Each one of these, as we shall see, has great detail. Okay, this is the overall map. Now, by the way, we're using something called the first, this is all done in my planning language, Plangwidge, which is the subject of the two books you're getting for free, right? And for years, we've been using as tools Word and Excel type tables. But thanks to a fellow called Richard Smith, who is, Richard, would you put your hand up and smile? Yeah. Richard was one of my students in Citigroup about 2005, right? Started doing this stuff in very interesting ways. And but finally, he said, I'm going to make an even better tool for Tom's methods. That will be my startup. So this is Richard's startup, this tool. Okay? So we happily use that. It's much better than spreadsheets. But you can do it with, you know, Word, everything we're doing here. But it just works better to have an automated tool. At this moment, we're using the tool for free. Richard hasn't taken a penny, much to his wife's disgust, I'm sure. But I do free courses, he says, my wife shakes her head. So what are you doing it for? But really, let's say it's in beta. And we've used it largely, very much at BCS. And we give them lots of feedback, so the tool gets better and better. So if you're interested in possible use of the tool, there's Richard. He'll be here all day, I hope, talk about getting a free license or something like that. It is a great architectural tool. You'll see where I'm here's more than all these you recognize. These are the needs and means tool. Now, so here's a second slide. Communication, monitoring, scalability. Now that's a value. So and maybe from a different project, probably. Yeah, there is communication, monitoring, scalability. Yes, somebody have a question? Okay. There it is. Okay. So here, if you like, is the a good example of what I call a thorough definition, a quantified definition, a clear definition. Okay. It's amazing how many real projects stop there. They have those three nice little words. For me, that's just a cross-reference tag. And then the cross-reference tag leads us to an area where we define a whole lot of things to make things clearer and richer and more useful. Okay? And I'm going to go through some of that roughly with you. Okay, ambition level, I refer to that as the bullshit level. This is where the CEO has said something about it, and or the prime minister, and you capture it with their name on it and said the CEO said that. You don't say it's bullshit, because that would be impolite. You say, thank you for your advice and direction, Prime Minister. We realize we'll help you make this more clear. That's our job, your job. Help make things clearer. How do we make things clearer? Well, we dive in and we define a scale of measure. Okay? That's simply a definition of that idea that allows you to put numbers on it. So, you know, I could say that my Tesla has ludicrous speed, but I could also tell you it goes 300 miles an hour, which would be more informative, and miles per hour is the scale. Now I'm allowed to put 300 on it, it's suitably impressive, you may be more than ludicrous. Maybe you thought ludicrous was only 150 miles per hour, or some thought it was 700, but now we've pinned it down. Okay, so it's that idea. So this is the key idea in everything is brought together in the requirements, in the design, and in the project management delivery of values by this scale, or in fact, a set of them, maybe 10 or 20, are monitoring and measuring everything going on in your feasibility study, as Lauren called it, and in your project. Okay, it's the at Intel, which I showed you one example from, they've been using this for 17 years. They have trained 20,000 Intel engineers voluntarily, not requirement, just kept. And it is the new IEEE standard for requirements. Yeah, that's what it is now. So they've just begun handing over the course material for it, like this week. Now, next item on our definition, stakeholders. And so we can have any set of stakeholders we like. What we're doing is saying these stakeholders are particularly interested in this particular one of 10 or 20 primary values that we're going to deal with. Okay. What can you do with that? Well, if one of the stakeholders forced you to change it, might be an idea to talk to the other primary stakeholders about that change. So you've actually set up a little steering committee for that one idea, and people, since they're so interested, they'll give you the time of day, they'll give you their opinion. If you gave them all the requirements and say, would you, does anybody have any comments, you get no comments. Okay? But now we're focusing, we do a lot of that. We have owners is another, there's an owner Brian. Owner means owner of the specification. Nobody else is allowed to change it, they just simply don't have the passwords to do it. So read only if you're not the owner. Okay, but stakeholders, it depends on how you organize it, but you can say they will always be consulted with any absolute non-trivial change to the thing. You know, automatic emails will go out to them. We will know who they are and their representatives and their emails, and any change will automatically trigger an email saying a change has been made. React if you like or not. Status is quite simply how bad things are at some given point in time, June 2017, or right now, but it could be a year ago, on this scale, so that's the level. For the area of London, time limit 30 minutes, so these are two of the parameters up there we're choosing. There are lots of other areas and lots of other time units, but we've chosen one dominant one. Wish, quite simply, the value that the stakeholder holds. They wish to get it to this level. Now, wish doesn't mean it's required in the project. It means that the architect has to find architecture to get there at all. And the architect has to find architecture that we can afford in time and people. And the architect has to find architecture that doesn't destroy the other 19 values with negative side effects. That's the architectural job. Okay? Now, if the architect can satisfy all those constraints, we have a valid piece of architecture we can try out. I believe architecture, and I'll move very deeply into this during the talk, architecture needs to be incrementally delivered, not all at once. The all at once is a disaster waiting to happen. Okay, let's say you have 50 to 100 bits of architecture if you decompose them. I really think each one should be delivered in a week incrementally. And you should measure how secure they are, what they cost, and make your decisions about what to do. So I'm going to talk about dynamic design to cost architecture and the practice of it for the last 40 years that you don't know about.
Can I just ask a question? Are you typical requirements fit a certain strategy as well?
The strategies must fit the requirements. Now, there is a superordinate strategy of how we do things. Let's call it engineering architecture,
yeah.
Which says you will quantify all the variable requirements, all the values, all the costs. No exceptions.
Because I wasn't too sure whether this is actually forming part of the strategy if you go to concrete stuff like the UK.
Yeah. Getting to these levels, they will be part of some strategy at some level. I've got a whole chapter in the value planning book, it's one of the two books on levels of concern, and you will find your answers. Thank you. There you go. But for example, it might be tied to the chief technical officer strategy, but not to the.
Because when you say stakeholders, when you talk about stakeholders and stuff, I just want to give you sort of.
Remember, these are student examples, but.
It's just a general point.
Okay, but that's some wishes. Now, when we found architecture that suits, we can convert the wish to a goal, and goal is a commitment of the project to actually deliver. If we do have architecture that will get us there, and we can afford it, and it doesn't destroy everything else. And so this is called setting expectations. Wish, we acknowledge your wishes, but we don't promise that there is any way of getting there. If I said, I want to get to the moon and back in 1 microsecond, no architecture. You can wish all you want. Get back and forth in a week or two, said, been done, can do, here's the cost. Yes?
Is the wish the perfect ideal state or the minimum?
No. Okay, it is the state that a stakeholder says, I'd be very pleased if I walked there. It's that state. It's not a maximization, okay? It's just that beyond that, I don't care that much. It has less value. But if I get there, I'm dead pleased. Now, we have other states that I'll be talking about called tolerable and stretch, which give other notions in that area. So wait for those to come up, because they're coming up in the slides. Okay. Yeah. Nice little thing, rationale. Rationale captures why the heck did anybody want that wish, which is very interesting information. As an architect, you could convert that into something they aren't even thinking of, realizing that, well, if that's their rationale, then you know, we could reformulate this and find some practical architecture. It's a very good practice to capture all kinds of background information. Now, for example, wishes are core information. They are the beginning of the requirement itself. But rationales and risks are background information. And I'm a very strong believer that about 90% of any requirement or design specification will be background about risks and owners and stakeholders. Okay, and it's essential that you capture that information and keep that information and keep it up to date. Okay. But people don't. You don't. Okay. So there's a lot more to this potentially, but then this is just the first slide. What happens if we go to the second slide? Well, we've actually taken a scale, and we get a window. Okay, and what the window, any one of these one-liners, which are nice for presentation, can be exploded into a window to get more detail. So here's the scale, the time in minutes to alert, and then we have a parameter, responsibility command types, from first 999 call for certain attack types. And the moment you put those in square brackets to say these are parameters to be defined, you automatically get an opportunity to hear like arson, cyber attack, airplanes, drones.